hardware. macOS, that's not hardware. Hi, I'm John Papa, and today I'm with
Christina Warren.
And we're going to talk about five things about developing on a Mac. Thing number one, developing on a Mac. Hardware, what do we need to know?
All right, so you can do a couple of things. You can have an iMac, an iMac Pro. There is a Mac Pro, although for anybody watching this in, say, the middle of 2018, I would advise against getting one because Apple's going to be releasing a new Mac Pro TBD.
In the fall area, maybe?
They haven't said, so, but we know it's coming. So the current Mac Pro is fairly outdated, so I would avoid that. But you can get a MacBook, MacBook Pro, or iMac Pro, kind of depending on what you want. I would say for most developers, the MacBook Pro is probably the best choice. There are some new models that came out in July of 2018 that have either 4 or 6 cores, so they're very powerful. And yes, they have a keyboard that some people don't like. But these are very powerful machines. It's going to be good enough to do, they're doing web development or you're building, you know, Swift or Swift apps or Objective-C apps. It can be very powerful and very good for development.
Thing number two, I like to use my iPad as a second monitor. Can you talk more about how that could help people out too?
Yeah, I like to do this as well. So what you can do if you have an iPad, you can basically connect it to your MacBook Pro or your MacBook or your iMac or whatever and use it as a second display. And what's great about this app, there's an app called Duet. And what's nice about it is that it actually physically connects to your Mac. So you use your Lightning cable, you plug it in, either USB-C or USB, and it mirrors content kind of acts as a second screen. And this can be really beneficial if you're traveling and you need a small second screen that you need to, you know, travel with, because you can't really, it's not easy to travel with a secondary monitor. Or even if you're just like at home and you've got your laptop and you're like, okay, but I would like to have a bigger screen. And I like this app a lot, I know you do too, because it doesn't have a lot of lag. Because the problem with some of the other like Bluetooth solutions is that they're laggy, so right, they're a few seconds behind. And that might not be a big deal in some cases, but especially if you're coding like a web page or something, just having a little bit of lag can really be frustrating.
So it's a nice, cheap way, inexpensive way, if you already have an iPad, to have a high-resolution monitor.
Yeah.
As an extension.
Exactly. And what's also great too is if you were to say you're developing something for like iOS, you probably need to have one of those devices anyway to test things on. So you might as well use it as a secondary screen too.
Thing number three, writing code on a Mac. There's a product called?
VS Code.
Yay!
So obviously you can use Xcode, which is the official Apple IDE, and that works really well for Objective-C and for Swift and things like that. But if you want a really great code editor, VS Code is not just a text editor, but it's kind of a full suite of things. And I honestly, before I started working at Microsoft, I never thought that I would genuinely be able to say that the best text editor on the Mac by far is made by Microsoft, but it's true. You can get all kinds of extensions for it for any of the languages you write in, whether it's JavaScript or Ruby or Python, but actually there is a extension for Swift. So in most cases, if you're writing in Swift, it probably makes sense to use Xcode because you're gonna be building your projects, but if you're just editing certain project files and you wanna make it consistent with your other environment, there's actually a Swift extension that you can check out that's maintained, that has code completion, and even has a built-in debugger.
Super, super fast editing, VS Code.
VS Code is amazing.
Thing number four, how do we do continuous integration and deployment for a Mac on Azure?
This is very cool. So actually there's something called Visual Studio App Center, and there are different build machines that are actually profiled to work with macOS and iOS. And so basically you've got a machine in the cloud that is running whatever version of iOS you need. It's got a built-in stack so you can do your CI/CD workloads. So if you're building an app using Cordova or Ionic or another kind of mobile development framework, you could actually do all your build stuff and your testing in the cloud, see the errors. You can even do things if you wanted to test to see how it's going to look and perform on various OS versions and various screen sizes, and say you don't have all those physical devices. You might have the iPhone 10 and the iPhone 6 Plus, but you don't have some of the other iterations. You can do those tests in the cloud too, and it's really easy to do.
So developing for the web with mobile applications made much easier this way.
Definitely, and what's great about it is that if your home Mac isn't that powerful, or even if you're on a machine that, say, you're not using a Mac, but you need to do some build deployment stuff, you can do it because it's all in the cloud.
And that link for that is?
It's right there, it's
right
somewhere.
There.
Somewhere.
Thing number five, Sometimes I'm building on a Mac, but that's not where I'm deploying to. So how do we work with that?
We containerize all the things. So Docker.
Docker.
So Docker for Mac is actually great because you can download a Docker image or many of them and just deploy them using Docker for Mac. And what's great about this is you can basically make your Mac setup look and act identical to what your server setup is. So because a lot of time your macOS is not really a server OS.
Right.
You're more than likely going to be deploying on Linux. And so it makes a lot of sense to just make sure that your build environment, your test environment, staging is all the same. And what's also nice about this is, say you're using something that doesn't have a native Mac SDK, but you want to use some of those features. Well, then you can just use the Docker container from that has that support, and then do all of your build stuff. You can still use your VS Code or whatever tools you need to do, and work with it just like you would anything else. And then if you did want to push changes to production, you can make sure you can feel confident that it's basically going to look and act the same.
Yeah, and we've got some great links for people to follow on this and how you can use Docker to build and basically mimic what you're being doing in production.
Yeah.
Christina, thank you for coming on.
Thank you for having me, John, and happy coding and development, everybody.
Thank you, and everybody, this was 5 things about developing on a Mac.